everyone, this is the Chrissy B Show. And if you're new, this is a program aimed at looking after our mental health and well-being. And today it's Makeover Day, where we'll be spoiling another very special person and also hearing their story. Last week, we had the pleasure of making over Lisa Hodgkinson, who told us about her failed relationships, drug taking, online cheating, her life as a single mum and depression, but also how she turned everything around. If you missed it, you can catch the episode on our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show. And today we're going to meet Kirsty Spence, who is a musician and songwriter from East London. She'll be telling us how music helped her to overcome her depression and helped her family members, some of whom also suffer from mental health issues. And she'll also be performing for us later on. But not before we treat her to a makeover done by our expert, Ursula Jones, who will also be giving us some makeup artist secrets. But first, let's take a look at this.
Do you know someone who deserves a makeover and would like to tell their story? Perhaps it's someone who's going through a hard time or is always thinking about other people and not about themselves. Let us pamper them here on the show. And you can even nominate yourself. Get in touch with us via our website, chrissybshow.tv, and you or your friend could be the next person getting spoiled and sitting on the sofa having a chat with Chrissy. And the pampering could continue because every month we give away a fabulous gift of a spa treatment courtesy of the luxurious Thai Square Spa in Trafalgar Square. You will feel like royalty, so don't delay. Get in touch today.
Also on the show today, I'll be giving you my tips on how you can use music to boost your well-being, but also how it can be detrimental if you're not careful. But now let's hear some news with the lovely Helen Ashard. Welcome to the show, Helena.
Thank you, Chrissy. So we've got lots of different news today. Yes. Starting off with the Rio Paralympics. Everyone's excited, everyone's inspired. Well, I'm very inspired, which is great. Dame Sarah Storey has become Great Britain's most successful female Paralympian by winning her 12th gold medal. Wow. So good for her. Yeah. But I was sad at some point because in August it was actually voiced that they'd only sold 12% of the tickets.
I know, it's really bad, isn't
it? And that's 300,000 and they were selling 2.5 million. Yeah. So low. So great that Prince Harry came to the rescue and lots of other people. Obviously, it was an initiative which was fill the seats, hashtag fill the seats. Yeah. And people gave lots of money, including Coldplay, who were very good at that. And 10,000 tickets were given to the local Rio children to see the Olympics, which is really good, isn't it? So I was pleased about that. Yeah. The great comedy series Cold Feet, I don't know whether you remember that at all.
I never watched it, but it's
actually really good fun. And I thought, is it a good thing to actually introduce it again? But it's good, it's really good. And the thing about it, it's a group of friends, and it showed them growing up like a big family. Mm-hmm. And it's just about their lives. Very simple, but really effective, and it's quite funny. And James Nesbitt and Faye Ripley, I think, are quite well-known actors, and that really did bump their career up. But now, the thing about it, 13 years later, you'd think, oh gosh, how can it be? But now it's about their children are older and everything. Yeah. But it also is introducing the stigma surrounding male depression, which I thought was very interesting. And it's because Cold Feet writer Mike Bullen suffered from depression himself when the show ended in 2003. Okay. So he's bringing that in with the character, which is brilliant because there's not really many series that bring that up.
No.
So I think that's
Which is crazy, isn't it, when you think about how big of an issue it is worldwide and then not many people.
And how many series we have in the, not just here in the UK, but everywhere. It's something to introduce all the time. Yeah. So I think that's great. So we all love it when people, as in high profile people, talk about mental illness, which raises the profile of problems and things. And it gets everyone talking. So I've got a few people that I'm going to talk about.
Okay.
There's recent things. Mm-hmm. Not all in a long line, so I'll bring things in sort of in bits and pieces. But Bruce Springsteen being the first person. So he's the American musician, singer, songwriter, humanitarian, incredibly successful. He's got a new book that's coming out. It's an autobiography, Born to Run, and that's out sort of in September time. But he's talking about his his crippling battles with depression and his fear of turning into his father, because apparently it really did take hold of his father. And he talks about how strong his wife is, Patty Schialfa, who really, every time really watches and looks after him and protects him, and every time he needs help, sorts him out, which is something really special. I mean, it's so great that he's brought this out and he's talking about it in all the media.
I mean, it helps the person as well that's going through it.
Yeah.
Not just the people that are obviously going to read the book, but
no, absolutely.
Just being able to put it out there and say, look, this is what I'm going through, and
definitely. So it was great. Moving on, so this is something we've discussed a few times, but a new report's come out, the Good Childhood Report from the Children's Society, and the charity report finds young girls in Britain are struggling with their appearance and their unhappiness, and it's actually soared in the last 5 years considerably, which is completely sad. I mean, we do know about this, but obviously being a new report, it's always good to talk about it. And 14% of girls aged 10 to 15 said that they're unhappy with their lives as a whole. I think the actual amount has gone up by 21%, which is huge. Absolutely
huge. It just seems
huge.
To just be on the rise. And
it does. But the funny thing that came out in this report is that the happiness levels among boys have actually remained stable.
Have they?
Yeah.
That surprises me, actually.
It is, isn't it, when you think about various different subjects. Yeah. But anyway, this is the Children's Society charity report. So, very interesting.
It's so sad that age 11, some of them, 11, 12, they're just not happy.
I know. When you think about our childhood.
I know. Childhood's supposed to be like, you know, what problems did we have at age 11? Like, most people, obviously, I know people have been through some serious things in their childhood, but
sort of innocent,
fun, nothing to worry about, nothing to stress about, and there's these young girls just saying they're unhappy.
Absolutely. So there's the newish NHS certified app, which encourages students to be more streetwise about mental and sexual health. Now, moving on from children to, this is mainly for students, but actually a good thing that people can click into. And the good thing about it is you actually don't have to be online to access all the information.
Oh, that's good.
Which is really good. It allows young people to get answers about common health questions, but also, you know, depression, you know, what to do if your friend feels anxious, self-harms, effects of drinking.
Okay.
So it's an amazing,
that's
amazing
really good.
App. Yeah. Another thing that I found interesting was when I was reading, is there's a big proportion of women addicted to exercise. I wish that was me. Sadly, it's not.
I used to have to admit.
I say it in jest, but, you know, actually this I feel is a little bit too much, because obviously exercise is good and it feel good and the endorphins, but these are people that are hooked to the natural endorphins high, and as a result they're sort of, they are quite high flying women, and they'll get up extra early to run, they'll then do long Bikram yoga sessions, so they're sort of working hard and exercising like 4 hours a day before going to work.
That's crazy.
Really heavy, isn't
I used to do like maybe a couple of hours every day, I'd like do, so actually sometimes I'd do like two aerobics classes back to back and then go to the gym.
You're
which was crazy,
good.
But no, it was,
you say
it wasn't
used to.
This was when I was depressed because I felt better doing the exercise, and then I was doing some crazy weights in the gym, really, like I was doing the same weights as some of the guys in the gym.
Really?
And I was really, really skinny. So it's like I had this, I was just pushing everything into it.
It's a similar kind of thing.
Yeah, it was. But I couldn't be without going to the gym. I had to be there because I felt better when I was there.
Yeah.
And it kind of like the feelings would last for a bit after I'd left the gym as well. But obviously,
so you crave that endorphin.
I had to keep going.
Yeah. So I do, yeah, I get it. So moving on to Demi Lovato, who's now 23, but obviously she was a childhood star from the Disney Channel, American singer-songwriter, etc. And she, when she was sort of just turned 18, she realised she was suffering from mental health problems, depression, eating disorder, self-harm. And she's recently been talking at the Democratic National Convention in America, and she's raising awareness for mental health, which is great, as we say. Yeah. And she spoke to millions of people about her personal journey battling with depression and got huge tears. Everyone, was so excited. And she ended up singing her her last song, which was called Confident. So that must have been fun. I didn't get to see it, but, you know, it was good. We all know Zayn Malik, ex One Direction. So he's recently been battling severe anxiety issues, and recently has cancelled his Dubai concert. He pulled out from Capital Summertime Ball, so actually all his concerts on his own he's not managing.
No.
And he's really trying to get help, and he is improving slightly, but he just
cannot. That's a big deal though, isn't it? If you have got anxiety and then you're trying to do a concert.
When you've got all those millions of people.
I know, it's just like...
scary.
It's brave that he's even sort of attempting it.
Yeah, I think so. And actually it's quite sweet, he said. He says he doesn't feel secure in anything he does, slightly worrying in anything, he says. And it's why sometimes he can come across the wrong way, slightly distant. Yeah. He's very stressed out trying to control how he is perceived and thinks about everything over the time. So he's over-processing everything. So I can see that. Selena Gomez also pulling out of her concerts, again in Dubai, severe anxiety, but actually related to lupus. She's got a condition called lupus, which I would think is quite a good one to do again for the show.
Yes, okay.
Autoimmune system. So she revealed she had lupus about a year ago, and it affects people in different ways, but anxiety, panic attacks, depression can all be effects. So she's obviously taken herself out.
Yeah.
And I hope we've got lots more time, because I've got more news. Should I carry on going? Brilliant. So Small Things campaign to promote mental health. It's a really good campaign that's just come out. And it's Time to Change Wales, reach out. And it's a campaign showing people that, you know, you don't have to be an expert to talk to others about their problem. Just simplicity. So people have been urged to do small things, such as, you know, going for a coffee, speaking to friends, relatives, you know, asking how people are, very simple things. Yeah. And it features champions such as TV presenter Matt Johnson. And each person is talking about their condition and chatting. It's actually very simple.
Good,
It's really, really very good. Moving on to Pokemon Go. Now, it did come out a little while ago, but at the moment it's an app. Pokemon Go, you know about it?
Yes, I do.
I actually haven't used it, and I'm sort of tempted.
Are you going to?
Not something I'm going to use, but just so I could try it.
Okay.
But so it's now been downloaded 500 million times. And the thing about it, it's Nintendo's first reality app. So obviously Nintendo, it's the 90s, I think, isn't it? And so the whole thing is you're hunting for pocket monsters. And it's got that location-based technology thing. I mean, I do think it's incredibly clever. I'm not quite sure.
It's crazy, and it sounds like a lot of fun, but I just think these things are just taking over. And people aren't interacting. That's my problem
with these things. They're not interacting, but there is a little bit. Because it's got the location-based technologies, it is actually helping players combat anxiety and depression. So there is a little bit of good in it, although I do know there's a flip side where people aren't watching and getting... Yeah. run over and things.
Yes.
Which is not...
Deal with your mental health issues, but get run over in the meantime. That's really good.
I'm going to say, there's a catchphrase, got to catch them all. So actually there's lots of people all doing the same thing, and it is allowing them to chat. Mm-hmm. But there's one lady says it, you know, as it is. So her name's Lola Phoenix, and she's 28, struggles with anxiety.
Yeah.
What I like is that Pokemon Go has encouraged me to go out more and do more things. That in turn has improved my mood, even in just 5 days. So it's you know,
all right, I still have my reservations about it.
But I thought it was another one I can just end on. Okay, so this is so we can keep talking. Brilliant. Something that I saw in fact today, which was really fun to see. So Iman, who we know, is a supermodel and the wife of the late David Bowie. She stole the show at Tom Ford's fashion show in New York Fashion Week. So she obviously, it was her first evening out since losing Bowie. And
they were together for years.
I felt there's something really sweet, because they never ever spoke about, you know how you get these high profile people and they want to just be seen everywhere together, you know, just doing silly, you know, cuddling and kissing just for everyone else.
They're doing it
for everyone else, aren't they?
Yeah, they're doing it just
for the good thing about them is they were really, really close. Yeah. They didn't ever show it. And people always wanted to find out about their relationship. And one simple thing that she said was, "My marriage is exactly as fabulous as you all would think," which is just a very simple thing. But anyway, the good thing about it is she came out, it's her first night out, and the first time she's spoken to the media. And she's saying it's been a really tough year so far, but she's holding up. So good for her.
Yeah, brilliant.
It's good to see her.
One more, really Helena. We want one more
for the road. No, just trying to think. I'm not too sure how many we've got here. I mean, there's so many different stories. I can't even think. But actually, talking about anxiety again, Nikki Lidbetter, who we've spoken about on a few occasions. We always say the same thing on this show. It's just so important that everyone should talk. And the more high-profile people that can talk, even better, because it just raises the profile of conditions and it just gets everyone talking. And she was talking about it, because it's a new story today. And of course, we've been talking about different people, but she was saying how important it is. And we just, we're for it. Let's carry on doing it.
Thank you so much for the news.
Thank you, Chrissy.
Thank you, and we'll see you again very soon. All right, guys, so don't go away, because after the break, we'll be seeing Kirsty's makeover and also be speaking to Ursula Jones for some makeup artist inside tips. So don't go away. Welcome back to today's program, everyone, which we have titled The Positive Influence of Music. And it's also our makeover day. So we've been treating Kirsty Spence, and here's a photo of her before. And here she is now. So looking absolutely gorgeous. Welcome to the show, Kirsty.
Thank you for having me.
And welcome also to Ursula.
Hi.
How are you, ladies?
Good.
Very well, thank you.
So now, Ursula, why did you go for this look on the beautiful Kirsty here?
Well, she's walked in and told me she had no makeup on already, so I couldn't believe. So look how flawless she is already. So we just put the slightest bit of minimal kind of makeup on her, but just wanted to make her lips pop. And really, I just wanted to go through some tips to kind of talk you through how you can kind of achieve this look. Again, she has the most amazing eyebrows.
Just something about her. She's obsessed with eyebrows.
I am.
That's a good thing.
Unhealthy eyebrows obsession with eyebrows. And my new favourite thing at the minute is this. It's from Barry M, and I know there's lots of different products on the market for defining your eyebrows. One thing I would say is, if you're going to do anything, try and define your eyebrows, because it just completely changes your face. It just opens the eye area, and it can lift years off you as well. So whether you do it with a pencil, you do it with powder, you know, whatever's going to make you feel comfortable. The one thing I would say, if you go in with a pencil, the harder the pencil, the easier it will be, especially if you're not sort of great at doing it or just started. The reason being, if it's a soft pencil, you can make mistakes a lot easier. So if it's a harder pencil, you know, you just have to apply a bit more pressure.
Okay.
With this product, if I just show you, it's a very, very fine powder. So what you would do is just work this through the brow. And it's so pigmented. I've actually used this on Chrissy as well today. And it just brings out the most wonderful colour of, I mean, you've got amazing eyebrows. So I didn't have to
do a lot.
You've
got amazing eyebrows, did you know that?
We'll kind of say it again in case you didn't get it. But it just really made her eyes pop. So this is a new favourite of mine.
Okay.
And then what we did next, so step two would be to prime, always prime your eyelids. The eyelid tends to get quite oily. There's lots, again, different types of primers on the market. This particular one we used was a MAC one. The one that I used on you, Chrissy, was a Maybelline one. So, you know, there's tons of different choices out there. Whether you put it on with your finger or a sponge or a brush, you literally just tap it on and let it dry, and then you can put the colour of your eyeshadow on. It's going to stop any creasing. I don't know if you've ever put eyeshadow on and then you see like a crease and you're trying to blend it away. This is going to stop the creasing, and it's also going to make the colour of the actual colour of the eyeshadow pop. So sometimes if you put an eyeshadow on, you don't get the true colour. This is going to give you the true colour of what the eyeshadow should be, and it's going to make it last. So always prime your eyelids. A third tip from me would be, so when you're setting your face with a powder, rather than going in with your typical makeup brush and sort of dusting it over, is to use these sponges. You can get them everywhere. They all come in different shapes and sizes, but you know, they do the same thing. You can put your liquid foundation on with this. You can put your concealer, and literally what you have to do is pat it onto the skin, and also make sure it's damp. So, you know, wet it under the tap, rinse it out, you know, dry it out a little bit with the towel. So it has to be damp. And then you're just sort of rubbing it into the skin.
Why is that better than a brush then, do you think?
I think it just makes it look more like skin, rather, you know, with a brush, you're kind of that motion, you know, you're painting the face.
Whereas and it goes everywhere as well, doesn't it?
It can do, but whereas this is really kind of working it to make skin look like skin.
Yeah.
So what I would say with the brush, what you tend to do is just dust the powder, the setting powder on top of the skin, is to use your sponge while it's still damp, and this is the one that we've used on Kirsty, dip it into the foundation or the powder, and you want to press it into the skin. Now the reason I say do this with the damp sponge is rather than a brush is because it's going to sit in the pores much better rather than it just lying on top of the skin. So this is really going to work it and make your skin look like skin.
Will it last longer as well?
It will, yeah, most definitely. So that's what we've just done.
Lovely.
Another top tip is with mascara, when you take the mascara out to make it last longer, never pump the wand back into the tube.
All the time.
Right. Me too.
Never pump your mascara. Simply, it's going to dry out. It's going to, you know, always chuck away mascara after 6 months. If you ever had
do not.
Right.
Get the last bits out.
Yeah. Water.
I don't like hearing this.
I've actually put olive oil in
I don't want to hear no more. So, never pump your mascara. If you ever do get sort of an eye infection or anything, bin it, because remember, if you're using it on your eye, it's going back into the pump and it's going to just create bacteria and germs. The same thing with the pumping of the wand, it's going to make the mascara dry out and it also get bacteria in there, you know? Okay. So, stay away from that.
Sorry.
You've been let off. And another top tip would be, we've put lovely lashes on Kirsty today and they look incredible. Mm. I love them on her. Some people aren't great with eyelashes. So a top tip would be, you know, rather than you would take the eyelash out of the packet, you would put the little glue that it comes with along the base of the lash, let it dry and then put it on. Sometimes what people find, it can slide around and then you get the glue on top of your eyelid. Yeah. So what you can do is get a brush. You can get these from really, really cheap, but you can get them from art stores, something that you're not sort of too bothered about getting a bit ruined. And then you press it onto here and then put it onto the eyelid.
Okay.
So you're putting the glue onto the eyelid rather than the eyelash, and then you can pick up the eyelash and place it, and then
easier.
It gives you more control. You don't get that awful, you know, gluey eye at the top of your eyelid, and it just makes it 10 times easier to put eyelashes on.
Brilliant. That's
so, yeah.
Lovely. Thank you so much.
You are more than welcome.
Thank you.
So is this something, is this the kind of look that you would normally go for? Is it?
It's definitely similar to what I would do, but I love the lips. Yes. The lips are my favourite. I've got a big thing about lips.
Amazing.
And Ursula did put we put a colour on first and it was quite lighter.
Yeah.
And then she said, do you want more? And I was like, yes. So we made it hot. Yeah. So yeah, it was lovely.
Thank you so much.
You're more than welcome. And guys, if you want to know more about Ursula, you can find her details on our website, chrissybshow.tv. But you will be joining us very soon again, won't you, Ursula?
Yes, most
definitely. Now, we're also going to be hearing your story a bit later on, because you do have quite a story to tell about mental health issues, not just for yourself, but in your family as well. And you're going to be telling us all about it. But first, guys, let's take a look at the story of a young man who manages his bipolar disorder by playing music in an unlikely place.
You know, you hear it chiming the hour and you think, oh yeah, it's completely computerized. I think a lot of people don't actually realize that there is a live person that is banging away up here. Each one of these is connected to a baton or key in the room downstairs. So when you pull it, literally all it does, pulls and rings a bell. It's another broken part. This thing breaks all the time. There's a running joke between mother and myself that the crazy runs deep in the family. Bipolar is, that's I think the worst for me, just because, you know, I can be doing something and completely happy and giddy. One thing can happen, and literally like that, I can just be completely opposite in a state of mind, and it's so difficult to try and come back. I was supposed to be on some kind of medication to just kind of even me out, and I hated the way that made me feel. I just couldn't stand it. It did cut down the lows and make it not nearly as extreme, but my rebuttal would be, why would you take, you know, the last little bit of joy in your life that you might still have and, you know, risk throwing that out the window, even if it means not feeling any downs? I just don't think it's worth it, honestly. It's not living if you're just a flat line constantly and can't get excited or upset about anything. That's part of the joys of being a human, I think, is just having a spectrum of emotion. Music is the most emotional thing there is. It's just so deeply rooted and individualistic in each individual person, I think, is what gives it just the power behind it. Probably the biggest challenge I face that music provides an escape is just absolutely crippling self-doubt. If you can focus deeply into, at least in my case, it's making sure performances are spot on, you know, trying to be a perfectionist with everything, it's a really good way just where you can concentrate solely on that. You just have the ability to completely block out everything else. My bipolar has been getting the best of me. I still go through wonderful high periods. My highs have gotten longer, which is wonderful. But God, when I hit lows, oh, they're usually about a two. You know, like the average person is like a six or seven, they're like twos. I've been at a one like once or twice. I usually try and do whatever I can to prevent myself from getting that bad, because that's dangerous territory. When you feel that bad, yes, the idea of killing yourself, it's absolutely terrifying. I won't lie, it's scary. But even though it is scary to think about death, it is still less scary than the idea of keeping going on and like staying alive.
Hey Jim, this is Austin Ferguson, and I am headed up to go play the carol, and I just wanted to give you guys a heads up.
The tower is an extension of me, I think. This place, it's just surreal enough, I think, that it really offers kind of an escape from reality for a little while. I don't keep anything about my mental health a secret. Like, I don't obviously go around with a shirt on it that says, you know, I'm crazy bipolar, ask me about it. I think it's a big part of my identity that, you know, I don't want it to be the only thing that people know about, but I'm definitely not ashamed of it. You learn to fight it and kind of cope with it. I had a voice teacher, her name was Rose Taylor. She was the most ardent supporter of me playing the carol and would come to every single thing I did. Rose's life motto was always surround yourself with bells so you can ring them when the good things happen. I'm very involved and plan to stay with the world of bells for the rest of my life. It's what makes me happiest.
Well, many thanks to the Mental Health Channel for that video. And if you want to know more about them, do visit our contributors section on our website, chrissybshow.tv. And I'd just like to highlight something that he said about the times he feels suicidal. He said, even though it's scary to think about death, it's still less scary than the idea of keeping going on and staying alive. So I just want to say it might feel that way, but that's not the reality. That's why it's so important to get the right help and support. Suicide is never the answer. And actually, we did a whole show recently in support of World Suicide Prevention Day, which you can check out on our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show. Well, guys, it's time for a break, and afterwards we'll be hearing Kirsty's story. Chrissy B, and my show is all about improving your mental health and being happy. Join me every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 10 p.m. on my channel, Sky 203. Visit chrissybshow.tv for more information and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Chrissy B Show and on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. Welcome back, everyone, to our show about the positive influence of music. And earlier we met Kirsty, and she had a lovely makeover, looking absolutely gorgeous, as you can see. But she's got a gorgeous smile, but she has been through something quite serious, and she's going to tell us all about it now. So, life growing up, would you say you were quite a happy child? And
yes, I've always been a very positive, happy child. Yeah. I think I definitely get that from my mum, because she kind of taught us that nothing is impossible. You know, get kind of certain family members that be like, you can't do that, mum would be like, yes, you can. Let's go and have an adventure. And
That sounds lovely.
Yeah, so we were quite positive, and we did have a good childhood. Okay. And I was always quite positive in everything that I did, and very outgoing. Mm-hmm. And if I believed in something, I would definitely do all I could to achieve it. So that's something that stuck with me since I was a child.
Okay. Then what happened to kind of change things for you?
Unfortunately, earlier this year, I lost my grandmother, and she was my queen. She was the connection her and I had was something that, you know, I don't know, we just had a very special bond. We understood each other without words. We could just be in each other's company, and I'd know if she was upset or she'd know if I was upset. And so it was a really tough time for me, and it was the first time I'd actually ever...
Was it quite unexpected? Was it a sudden death?
She had been ill for quite a long while. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it was one of these things where it was kind of when we were at the hospital, it was like 1 minute she was very low, then she... you kind of live off hope, don't you?
Yeah, yeah.
And unfortunately, she passed away on the 3rd of February. Mm-hmm. And it's really the first experience of death that I've ever been around or subject to, especially of a close relative.
Yeah, yeah.
And obviously, I did not know what to do. I found myself in a very kind of low place. I'd lost one of my best friends. And it was a case of, I suppose, do you sit at home and stay in a room, which I did for a while, and just, you know, cried because I've lost somebody. Yeah. But then,
which is normal, isn't it? When we lose someone, you know, you do go through that period.
That stage, yeah. But my grandma was such a positive, powerful woman. And she always used to say to us, you have to fight the good fight with all your might and hold on to eternal life, and it shall be your joy and crown eternally. And when she passed away, it was something that I just manifested.
Yeah.
And every time I felt upset or I felt low, I'd think grandma would be behind me being like, why are you crying?
Yeah.
You need to get up and do what you need to do. Mm-hmm. And as a singer-songwriter, I have a gift, as I explained to you earlier, that, you know, not everybody has. And it enabled me, you know, these emotions that I was feeling, this sadness that I was feeling, this negativity that I was feeling, I was able to put it into words, whether it be poetry or whether it be a song. Or
how were you trying to do it before you actually kind of had this kind of, we'll say, wake-up call in a sense, but how were you trying to cope with it before that?
Before writing?
Yeah.
I just didn't really know what to do. In all honesty, I had no idea what to do.
That just taken over you?
Yeah, completely. I just kind of thought a lot about a lot of things. You know, you kind of feel a bit lost. Where do I go from here? You know, obviously everybody within the family was very upset. So it's kind of like you don't want to put your burdens on other people. So, you know, I've got two amazing flatmates that are like my sisters, and they were there for me. They were like my rock. So we'd have lots of chats and, you know, takeaways and hot chocolates and bottles of wine. Yeah, and all of that, you know, and to help me through. But then it was kind of, my grandma always wanted me to help people. She always said, Kirsty, you need to help people. You should be a nurse. You should do this.
She sounds amazing.
She was. She absolutely was. Yeah. And she gave me her blessing to sing before she passed away. Mm. And she said, Kirsty, you need to help people because people will listen to you. You're a very positive person and you're very honest. And I think that's something that just resonated in my mind constantly. Yeah. So rather than maybe, you know, when I'd feel upset, I'd literally pick up a book and write down exactly how I was feeling.
Okay.
And then maybe I'd put on a piece of music and write to that piece of music. And then before I know it, I'm writing a song or I'm writing a piece of spoken word or I'm writing, you know, some poetry. And I just felt it was almost like musical therapy.
Mm-hmm.
It was a way after I'd done that, after I'd said that song, I found that I'd get really upset and I'd cry. Yeah. But it was almost like a release.
Just letting it all out.
Yeah, like I've let it all out. And I've let it all out through this process of writing down exactly how I feel. And from that, I actually wrote three songs because my grandma's favourite number was three. and I called my little package of songs Fight the Good Fight after her, in memory of her. And so, yeah, it's just something that I've manifested and I've just been trying to, you know, I've been performing those songs recently since she passed away. And it was, I suppose, beautiful because one of the most reoccurring comments and feedback that I would get is that, Kirsty, you really touched us. We felt where you were coming from. And that is what I want to do with my music because, as you say, everybody goes through a time in their life where they will lose somebody. Or everybody will go through a time in their life where they're feeling low or they're feeling depressed or they're feeling helpless. And it's like, if you can listen to one of my songs and I can make you smile or I can give you that motivation to get out of bed, that is what I want to do. This is why I do what I do. And that's amazing. That sometimes it's all about, I always say, you know, sometimes people need a pillow. And that pillow might be, I don't know, going for a jog or going for a run. My pillow is music. And music is a language that everybody speaks. So if I can put that out to an audience or, you know, to anybody, just to hear that song and it makes you feel uplifted and positive, then that it makes me feel uplifted and positive, giving you my gift. So if you receive it and that's how you feel, that's amazing.
That's lovely. And just a question, Kirsty. So you were writing before your grandmother's death as well, or did you? So would you say that you've maybe even become a better writer than before, or more into the songs?
I feel like I've become more honest. I feel a huge thing with me when it came to songwriting. When I first started singing, I used to have terrible stage fright. It was almost like an anxiety. I would sing, you know, in the shower, and then as soon as someone would say, Kirsty, can you sing? I'd be like, no, I can't. Yeah, because my fear was, if I was to let you know my true, honest feelings or how I felt, and you didn't like that, I felt like, that's really going to hurt me. When actually, I suppose it's about stepping through that fear and just being honest.
And being yourself,
and
right?
being
just
me.
Like,
yeah, completely.
That's really nice.
And I feel that it's helped me grow as a singer-songwriter. It's helped me grow as a person. It's helped me grow as an artist. And I feel like I'm in such a better place. I'm probably the best me I've ever been at the moment, which is really, amazing.
All right. Where do you want to take your music? What are your goals and dreams for the future?
My goals and dreams are just to take it worldwide. I want people to hear everything that I have to say. I want to try and make a difference in the world. I believe a lot of my writing is to do with how I feel or about situations I'm living in. So living in London, you know, there's loads of things going on at the moment, whether it's racial tension or lack of education or mental health, which is a huge topic for me because I feel like we live with this stigmatism of mental health being quite a negative thing. And I believe that, you know, many of us at least know one person who suffers
from
mental health.
You've actually got an uncle as well, haven't you?
Yes, I do. I have an uncle and he suffers from bipolar. And, you know, it's a situation that you have to accept. There's times when he's up, there's times when he's down. And I feel that when I've been observant and I've been in situations with him, maybe when he's on a high and he's having like a bit of an episode, people look at him in fear. And he's the most harmless person ever, you know. And I feel like
For people that don't know much about bipolar, can you just maybe describe what an episode actually involves?
You can literally flip, so you can be really, really low and depressed, or you can be really energetic and really like, you know, I want to get up and go, and almost a little bit irrational, and, you know, maybe nothing, it may not make sense to you, but in his mind, or in any person's head that has bipolar, it makes sense to them. And I suppose, like I say, the biggest thing is acceptance, but I also feel like we need to educate people about mental health, because the fear, again, it's that fear of not knowing what it is, whereas if you have more of an understanding, you'll be more accepting of
it. That's the same with anything, because if you think about it, someone that doesn't know anything about bipolar and sees those episodes and thinking, oh my God, what's going on with it? 1 minute, 1 second, you're like this, and now you're like... It is confusing for people because they don't know what it is.
And they
just think, this is strange, this is really weird, this person, let me keep away from them. And like I said, it does scare people. But that's because, you know, if we're not talking about these things and not explaining, well, this is what happens, expect this kind of, you know, reaction or whatever, and if we'll start to educate people, then there'll be more understanding, then, you know, things are going to get better. But until then, like, we can't just live in fear and just ignore these things. We have to talk about it.
And I feel like through my music, I suppose it enables me to have a voice.
Yeah.
I have that platform where I can reach out to a lot of people. So whether it's I can educate you, I suppose, in a way about experiences I've seen or I've been around or I've been through myself in regards to these topics that I'm passionate about and that, you know, people talk to me about. Mm-hmm. If I can, you know, sometimes how you can sing a song and you don't even realise you've consciously picked up the lyrics because it's on constantly or it's catchy or the chorus is catchy.
Yeah.
And then kind of when you look back on those lyrics and you actually see what they're talking about or you hear a, you know, a celebrity or musician talking about where they came from and you're like, wow, I had no idea that that was it. I feel like things like that are very powerful.
Yeah.
And that is what I want to try and achieve through my music.
Now, the song you're going to sing for us today is...
Yeah. It's called The Fight.
The Fight, okay.
Yeah. And it's from...
So it's out of the set of three that you wrote. What are the other two called? Just that
so we've got... well, there's actually an intro, which is my grandma saying, fight the good fight, her speech.
Okay.
And then there is a song called Untitled.
Mm-hmm.
Then I have a song called Drifting. And then the final song is The Fight.
Okay.
Yeah.
And tell us about that one. Just tell us
a fight?
Bit. Yeah.
The Fight is basically... It is about everybody having to fight the good fight. So it's basically about, you know, everyone has to go through their lows to come back and be at a high point in life. So no matter how low you get, just always try and remember you're going to rise again. And yeah, that's basically what it's about.
Amazing. Okay, so it's time now for Kirsty to get ready and sing for us. And also after the break, I'm going to be giving my own tips as well on the influence of music. So let's now go to Kirsty.
As a little girl, I'd do anything, alright, to get out the house and I wear my phone and my fire light. Pull it tight like, pull it tight for, get the shite and put everything from wrong back to right. I'm here to fight the fight I did not even know was mine to fight like, mine to fight, hey. I try to let it go. Shoulders right, I can see my future's in sight. With bright lights and a mic, you ain't holding me tight. You ain't holding me tight like, reach that height, oh, it's in sight, oh. I'm on a journey on my own, this is my time. The pieces may not fit the fight, but it's alright like, it's alright, oh. I try to let it go. Put right, but do you let it all go, or do you keep up the fight? Keep up the fight, put pen to paper, let the art write. Love is what's real, the future is bright. I said, put pen to paper, let the art write. Love is what's real, the future is bright. Hey.
Welcome back to our program, everyone, which has been all about the positive influence of music, and it was, of course, also our makeover day. So if you've missed the beginning of this program, don't worry, because you can head over to our YouTube channel in a few days' time, which is Chrissy B Show, and watch everything from there. And also don't forget to subscribe, because there's so much on there that's great for your mental health and well-being. So now I'm going to be speaking about how music helps or hurts. So we heard so many positive things about music, and yes, it does help many people, but I'd just like to maybe talk about a few more things that we also have to watch out for. But let's see some of the other benefits. My first point is,
Music stimulates you to work out. So according to a publication in Medicine and Science in Sports and Exercise, listening to music during intense yet unpleasant exercise makes the workout more enjoyable and actually pushes you to work out harder. And I can definitely vouch for that. Anytime I'm doing a class and there's a nice beat that I like, it does really help me and push me to do much more. So in that sense, it is very motivating. And I'm sure you guys that exercise can relate to that. I mean, I can't imagine, for example, people going running without music, because that I think that would be so boring. So it definitely helps with that. My second point is, music changes your mood. So music can have a positive impact on our mood. So if you're feeling down and maybe you put on a nice, you know, nice track, something positive, it can actually lift you and put you in a better state of mind. But you also have to be very careful, because the opposite is also true. So if we take the example of maybe someone's just broken up with a partner, if you're then going to go and listen to all these sad songs or to all these love songs, and you're going to start missing the person, and maybe you'll start listening to the music that, you know, relates to the two of you, things maybe that you listen to together, that is just going to get you really, really depressed. So it's best in those kind of situations not to listen to romantic music or nice lyrics, things like that, because it's going to make you feel worse. So you have to kind of be careful the way you're using music. The third point is, music is said to help you to sleep better. So if you are finding it difficult to get off to sleep, light music can be a way to help you, you know, get that rest that you need. And actually, music's been proven to be an effective method for helping adults to catch some sleep, according to a study published in the Journal of Holistic Nursing Practice. Which, you know, is true for many people. I personally, it puts me off if I try to sleep and there's noise in the background, but I know for some people it definitely works. The fourth point is, music helps you to relax. So blood pressure readings revealed that listening to pop or jazz music in particular had the same restorative effect as total silence. So again, I mean, me personally, I think the best music for me that I love is the music of nature. So I love listening to the waves, the birds singing. I love, you know, when the leaves rustle in the wind. I love all of that. For me, that relaxes me more than the music. But I know for some people, definitely, it really works for you. And my fifth point is, music influences you, so either positively or negatively. So when you are actually listening to music, if the lyrics are very positive, that's great, it will influence you. But there is so much, I would say, trash out there that is really, the lyrics are really bad. And sometimes you could be, you know, dancing to a beat because you think it sounds really good. But if you listen to the actual words, the negative words that are being said, I mean, there was a particular song, I thought the beat was great. And when I actually looked, I thought, hang on a minute, I thought I caught something very negative there, very condescending, horrible lyrics. When I went to look up the actual words of the song, I was shocked. I was really shocked. And I stopped immediately. I said, I'm not going to bop away to that. So see what you're actually listening to and what you're actually repeating as well, especially if you are maybe listening to music just before you go to sleep, and it does help you to sleep. If you think about it, those words, if they're negative, those words are going into your mind and they're staying in your brain, and that is not going to have a good effect. So make sure you're listening to something positive. And you know how it is with youngsters nowadays, when they listen to these kind of songs that maybe put women down or has a lot of swearing or is very sexual. All these kind of words are not good for young people. So even if you're a parent, do maybe watch out for what your kids are listening to, and maybe advise them in the best way to maybe listen to something a bit more positive. Okay, so those are the 5 points that I had regarding music, whether it's good or bad for you. But something I would like to leave you with personally, don't use music as a way of avoiding your problems. And I have spoken about this before. I used to listen to a lot of music before, and I always had to have my headphones on, and like the music was turned up really high, because for me, it was just a way of forgetting my problems, making me feel a bit better, putting my mind somewhere else. And, you know, I know people really, music really, really does help them, but I think it can also work it can be a disadvantage for you, because if you're using that music as a way of escape, you could actually be avoiding the problem itself. So if you are going through a mental health issue, like in my case, it was depression, you could be trying to just sort of avoid the problem instead of facing it. The best thing to do is to actually deal with the problem, face the problem, get the help for what you're going through. And you can use music as a way of enhancing your life, not as a substitute for happiness. So make sure you are actually dealing with all of your issues, and not just with music, actually with any kind of problem that you're going through. If there is something that you're using as an escape, whether it's exercise, whether it's another person, whether it's, it could even be your children that you're using as to make you feel a bit happier, that's very dangerous, because that, take those things away, what are you going to be left with? Are you just going to be miserable because you don't have those things in your life? So do deal with the issues first. Whatever you're going through, make sure you face them head on and get the help that you need as well. Well, we have reached the end of this program, everybody, but if you have a story that you would like to share on this program, don't forget it's your program too, so you can get in touch with us via the website, which is chrissybshow.tv. You can also tweet us at chrissybshow or leave a message on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. And if you want to get in touch with me personally, you can email me on chris@chrissybshow.tv. And also, if you want to find out more about how I overcame all the mental health issues that I used to have, you can visit my personal website, mylifeafterdepression.com. Until next time, bye-bye for now.
I had a really great time. Makeup was amazing and I learned lots of great tips. And obviously meeting you, Chrissy, was amazing, and I thank you for having me.